r/credit. Forest Rangers, what are your unexplainable and downright creepy stories? I told this story on Let's Not Meet, but I'm happy to tell it again. In 2016, my boyfriend, now my husband, and I went camping in eastern Pennsylvania. The place we decided to stop for the night was primitive. Camping was free, no cell service, barely a road, etc. We did encounter two other people. They might not factor into what happened later at all, but they were creepy, so I'll describe them. The first was a woman who had her truck off to the side of the road a little as we drove past. She had the hood open, and seemed to be waiting for someone to stop and offer to help. Usually my boyfriend had no problem helping someone, but he said his time something about her put him off. She didn't really seem like she needed help, and usually people who need help look at you hopefully as you approach. She looked like she just expected we would stop. That's what my boyfriend said anyway. I hadn't really noticed anything that strange about her. The next person came when we had chosen a spot and were setting up a fire for hot dogs. I had noticed people drive by a few times, but my boyfriend pointed out each time was the same car, and the man in the car watched us each time he passed. My boyfriend was a little uneasy about this, but we had driven around for a while before finding a place we liked. It had been raining and everything was muddy, and we wanted the driest site possible. He could have been doing the same thing. We briefly thought about moving, but the road was muddy too. If he wanted to find us, all he had to do was follow the tracks. There were some other tracks, but not many. He'd only have to backtrack a little to locate us again. He didn't come by another time, so we stayed and spent the several remaining hours before dark goofing off. No one else drove by. Whether or not those two had anything else to do with our experience, the real fear came later. We had gone to sleep in our tent, and sometime around 3 a.m. we were awoken by this very loud noise. I can't describe it very well, or even remember exactly what it sounded like, but my boyfriend said it reminded him of a chain gun revving up. It was also similar to how it would sound if someone recorded a shovel being dragged over gravel and played it over a loudspeaker, is another way he described it. He jumped up and looked out the little window, but couldn't really see anything. The sound repeated itself another few times. I was too scared to speak, so my boyfriend whispered that it was probably miles off, and I should go back to sleep. I didn't question this, as I figured loud sounds could be easily heard miles off. After we left, he told me it sounded like it had actually been coming from just down the road, but he didn't want to freak me out. Looking back, I probably should have wondered why he would bother to whisper if apparently the sound was far off. I was still terrified. Every little thing I heard outside sounded like someone was walking around the tent. We laid there for a while longer when finally my boyfriend told me to get dressed because we were leaving. I got alarmed by this, and even more alarmed when he unwrapped the machete we had bought just for this trip from its plastic before opening the tent. We quickly packed up and loaded the car. I looked around for footprints that weren't our own, but despite the moon providing plenty of light, I couldn't really see. I did point out something my boyfriend hadn't noticed though, before we got into the car. There was a beer can by our dead fire that hasn't been there before. We didn't even bring beer. While we were driving away, my boyfriend explained that he was nervous someone might have been trying to lure us out, so he didn't think it was a good idea to run from the tent right away. He also half expected to find out gas tank had been siphoned out, but that wouldn't have stopped us because we had a hybrid car. We joked that that would make a funny hybrid commercial. Number of brutal murders avoided by driving a hybrid. 2. We only joked because we were about shitting ourselves from fear and adrenaline even then. The rest of our trip we only stayed in well-populated campsites or got a hotel. Traditionally, not a ranger, but my story is the exact reverse of the others here. When I was in the scouts, or rather the local equivalent, legally adult scouts had to do the three feather challenge. One day without food, one day without speaking, and one day and night alone in the woods with only a knife and a tarp, unseen by any human. After which one has to sneak back to the scout camp unnoticed by the sentries and report to the camp master. It was my third day, so I took off, walked for miles through the woods, and found the most remote spot in the wildest, most overgrown part of the woods. Spent a spooky but uneventful night until almost before dawn, when I decided to go for a morning swim in the lake, right before taking off to go back. I stripped nude, and went towards the lake, but noticed a group of guys fishing so decided to go back. Suddenly, the ground underneath my feet caved in, and I found myself submerged up to my armpits in the absolute vilest mess I have ever smelled. It was a pit where poacher dumped the guts and leftovers of illegally hunted deer, and it fermented for weeks. Imagine the scene. A group of anglers hear some ungodly screaming from the direction of the woods, and run there to see if someone needs help. What they see is a teenager-shaped gal covered completely in blood and rotten offal, who is crawling out of a bloody hole in the ground, while shrieking and weeping, then runs at them to get to the lake and wash off. One of my best buds from college was a geologist major that ended up becoming a ranger in the Southeast US. Haven't spoken in years, as is the case with age, but I remember about 8 to 9 years back he was telling me about an old, married couple that he had recently helped out. He had seen them come to the park several days in a row, and found out they were visiting from out west, and they had gotten engaged there decades prior. They had been searching for a spot, they'd taken pics of where he popped the question, but were having trouble. After looking at the pics, and figuring out roughly where they were trying to get to, he escorted them in his vehicle, then hiked with them to where he thought it would be. They found it, and he left them there, and went back to his station at the entrance. He said he got a weird feeling once he got back, and felt like he needed to wait to see them whenever they left. Well, once it came time to lock up at night, he still hadn't seen them leave. So he reported it, left his assistant to wait at the shack at the entrance, and went back to where he left them. He found both of them lying down spooning along the bank of the river. Neither were alive. He called the cops, went through the 9 yards, and went home. The police were able to disclose to him their identities, but weren't sure anything else initially. Later he learned that the wife was terminally ill with cancer, and they had both committed suicide by ingesting some sort of chemical/pill combination medley. They just chose to do it where they had gotten engaged at. My bud wasn't torn up about it. He was obviously sad for about them dying, but said that he thought they hadn't asked for help earlier because they didn't want anyone to think they helped kill them. To be clear, I'm not forestry, I just have a related story. My cousin is with the Forest Service in the Montana/Wyoming area, and I decided to go up there with her to literally test the waters. She does hydrology and has to ride out to the middle of nowhere to test streams and snow runoff to ensure no contaminants. So I thought that sounded fun, and wanted to do a bit of a tour with her. We were going to have to camp out there for 2 nights, so we packed up all our gear in saddlebags or saddle bundles and started out. The first day and night was amazing. Beautiful scenery and amazing air quality. It really is so peaceful out there. I love that area, and wish I got to go up there more often. Anyway, we started out on the second day and my cousin said, "You want to see something weird?" Of course I said yes, so she led me on a bit of a side journey into this tiny little ravine. We ended up traveling about 2 hours away from our actual path we had laid out. At the very end of this fold in the land, she dismounts and tells me to get off my horse too. We tie them up in this gorgeous little clearing, and she tells me to follow this tiny wildlife path and bring our little rechargeable radio. It is one of those you can plug in or wind up, and it also acts as a lantern if you really needed to, but that kills the batteries quickly. I do, and out in the middle of fucking nowhere, there is a huge coil of wire sticking out of the ground. The wire itself was not weirdly large, like some buried transmission wire, but small, like 10 or 12 gauge wiring for a house. It trailed off into the brush and trees, so naturally I decided to follow the damn thing out of curiosity. My cousin trails behind me as I do, and this wire, after coming straight up from the ground, is strung across limbs of trees, then back to the ground, then it snakes around rocks and finally dead ends into an outlet. That outlet is mounted on the side of a desk. It looks like a school teacher's desk from when I was growing up, with a metal base and a pseudo wood slash plastic top thing. No chair, no building, no nothing, just this outlet and this desk. I'm staring confused as all hell at this desk in the middle of a forest, when my cousin takes the radio, pulls out the cord, and plugs it into the outlet. That fucker then lit up, and started blaring static. The wire was being fed from somewhere. Now, the place where we were, had no road access, no buildings for many miles, and no other people around. And yet, there was a live outlet. Weird as shit. No spooky jump scares or bodies, just one lone powered desk in the middle of the woods. I wish I had taken a picture of it. Not a ranger, but was hiking in Andorra with a friend. Long story short, we got lost off the trail, and ended up in Spain. Found another trail and we are following it, without a map. A while ahead of us, we see a man with two golden retrievers walking in the same direction we are. He looks young, and is carrying climbing gear over his shoulder. We are rushing down the trail, to catch up with him and finally do. We ask him for help with directions, and he tells us exactly where we are, and where we need to be. About 12 kilometers away there's a town with a hotel. He says there's another, smaller, town about 6 kilometers away, and that he parked his car there. He says he can give us a lift for the last 6 kilometers if we like, but says that he's in a hurry. We are over the moon, and so we hike together for a while. The dogs are nice and friendly, running circles around us. We are chatting away to the guy, and he is really nice, but my friend and I are getting tired, and so we cannot keep pace with him for long. The trail bends away to the right and the man, now a bit ahead of us, disappears behind the bend. We get there a couple of minutes later, and the trail is empty, no man, and no dogs, even though the trail is a straight run for quite a while and we should been able to see them. The two of us continue on, alarmed, waiting to hear slash see something, or perhaps be murdered by a stranger. Nothing. We get to the town eventually, and from there made it to the safety of the hotel in the next town over. We were completely freaked out by his sudden disappearance, and to this day we are both convinced he was a ghost. Ex-ranger here. We had a group of frat boys making way too much noise. We came by twice, and at the second stop, I told them, "This is your last warning." Not only is it rude for other campers to be so loud, it's exceptionally dangerous. Everyone knows that the local mountain lions are attracted to loud noises at night, and these ghost cats, as they are called, can creep right up on you without you hearing or seeing them. Whatever you do, don't leave your tent tonight. If you hear anything, don't make a sound. We went back to the station, grabbed the lion pelt from the interp center and the night vision goggles. Head ranger had to blow what was left of the budget at the end of the previous year. Once they were all in their tents, we crept into the campsite, and made fake lion tracks everywhere. We set up the lion pelt propped up over some sticks. The other ranger got out the PA, and from a distance, started doing fake lion calls, slowing getting closer. I pulled the jeep forward, like we were arriving on scene, and got out. Turned on my mag light, and illuminated the silhouette of the lion pelt. Because I was moving quickly, the shadow of the lion appeared to me moving. At this point the frat boys were losing it. Jim, the other ranger, shouted, "Stay in your tents," followed shortly by, "She's coming around at us, and then there's another one. And finally, let's get the fuck out of here." At that point, we turned off the flashlights, grabbed the lion pelt in the darkness, and jumped in the jeep and sped off. Just after sunrise they started peeking out of the tents. Nobody was brave enough to get out, until about 8:30, when they saw all the huge paw and claw prints everywhere they really freaked out. Not a ranger, but back in 2010 I had just finished a wilderness leadership class, and decided to go to Colorado, to get some solo wilderness time. I found out about some hot springs near the Colorado River, that were only accessible during the winter. During the summer the snow melt raises the water level of the river, and they become submerged, and decided to go spend a few weeks out there. It was on BLM land, and I had about a 4-mile hike from where I parked to where I was camping. The BLM lady who watched the land saw me when I arrived and asked me to just write the date on my windshield every week. to let her know I'm still alive out there. Anyways, it was pretty pleasant out there, but every night I was terrified of the bears. They should be sleeping, but if they aren't, it means they are hungry as fuck, and I'm for dinner. For this reason, I decided to set up camp close to a cliff. It was about 40 feet down to the river, and I figured, worst case scenario, I could jump and then get to the hot springs to prevent hypothermia. It's a crazy plan, but once you're out there, you realize bear spray is kinda useless inside the tent. So one early morning, I hear these loud animal noises outside my tent. They are getting closer and very loud, accompanied by grunting and breathing noises. I was too scared to open my tent. I just froze. And the steps kept getting closer and closer and closer. At this point, I could hear it sniffing my tent. I don't dare move. I just lay there. It starts to move away from my tent, but it's still out there, and now I hear more than one animal. I finally poke my head out, and it's a herd of elk. I swear though, it was probably the most scared I've ever been out camping. Not a ranger, but I used to be in a group that's somewhat like the scouts. So we spent a lot of time in the woods, and some weird shit happened often, but most of the time it was easy to explain. One thing happened though that to this day scares the living shit out of me. I was a leader for the age group 8 to 10 years old, and we were out on a camping trip. It was the first year we stayed on that terrain, and it was huge. Normally we tend to explore the majority of a terrain before the kids arrive, so we were aware of any possible dangerous spots to avoid. This time it was impossible. Every camp we have what we call a night game. It's usually a scary game in which the kids have to complete several tasks, while the leaders scare the ever-loving shit out of them. Obviously we had one too during that camp. We masked up as monsters, and hid out in the woods close to the checkpoints they had to pass. While running in between checkpoints, I found an open stretch of forest with little to no foliage, so it was ideal for chasing after them. There was no real room to hide besides behind trees, so I couldn't use my flashlight, or they'd be able to see me from miles away. It was dark, like the unsettling kind of dark that plays tricks on your eyes and you start imagining things that aren't real. During my stay there, I saw a shadow that was around my size running past me a few times. I couldn't see it very well, so I just assumed I was imagining things, because nothing was there when I turned my flashlight on. The game was nearing its end, and I saw the shadow again. This time I could see it vaguely standing near a tree not too far away from me. I thought it was one of the other leaders hiding to scare kids, and decided to go over there as it was about time to go back. I aimed my flashlight towards the tree, and while getting closer I noticed that there was indeed someone standing there dressed in what looked like a torn burlap sack, and had their head covered with a few white plastic bags that looked like they were tied together. I started to feel pure dread. Something felt really off. I asked if everything was okay, but they didn't respond. The only thing I heard was this weird sound that sounded like someone knocking on wood. Nevertheless, I went a bit closer until I was about 10 meters away from this person. The knocking sound turned out to be that person smacking his head repeatedly into the tree, and I noticed he looked like a male. He was barefoot and his arms and legs were covered with crusted mud. His hands were in a weird cramped position. I was convinced this was just one of the other leaders pulling a prank, so I told them to knock it off. He slowly turned his head and started walking towards me. Something inside me just told me to run. It didn't matter if it was just a stupid prank, and I ran away scared for nothing. If this wasn't a prank, it felt like I was in serious danger, so I ran as fast as I could. I heard him running after me, but I didn't want to turn around to look as I'd probably run into a tree. I arrived back at the campsite, and every single person that could be dressed like that was already there. They couldn't have gotten there before me, and if they did, they sure as hell didn't have the time to change into their regular clothes. Still, I told them, and that they gave me a good scare with that. They just looked weird at me, thinking I was trying to scare them, and we left it at that. Next day I wanted to go check it out. Who knows, maybe some weirdo ate the wrong mushroom and might be out there dying from hypothermia. I took someone else with me just in case, and there was nothing but endless trees. We arrived at the tree where I saw the person banging his head, and there was a dead, skinned, decomposing rabbit nailed to the tree. We called the cops. They looked around quickly and brushed it off as just a prank from another scouting group or some kids from the nearby town, and left it at that. We didn't notice anything weird after that, so it probably was a dumb prank, but seriously, some people have a fucked up sense of humor. Edit. This has had a lot more responses than I thought. To clarify, I'm 99% sure it was a prank by locals. The cops reacted in a way that looked more like not this fucking bullshit again than oh no, evil murderer in the woods, and we won't stop it. I was in the Jilla wilderness and a convoy of us campers slash fishers were making the drive on the dirt road from Magalan to Snow Lake when we spotted a forest ranger guy pulled over looking in a ditch. Turns out some idiot tried to make a U-turn and didn't realize the loose rock makes it hard to stop. They went over the edge and high-centered. We are miles from the nearest official campground and it's early spring and the nighttime gets pretty damn cold. We get a jeep with a winching position and start to pull the guy out of the ditch. Off a hill comes a white dude in a purple velvet sweet suit. He's got a walking stick, fanny pack and the purple velvet sweet suit. That's it. He's a blonde dude and pretty skinny. He comes up to us and he tells us he's German and having a great time. We could not get over the purple velvet suit. It was like a real pimp sweet suit. The ranger is immediately suspicious, wants to know where's he staying and where he came from. It was around 9 o'clock in the morning and the only way he could have gotten where he came from was to hike for hours. The German guy is a goofy fuck and just points off toward the other mountain when asked where he's staying slash going. We all think it's funny, but also question how the guy's getting along with no water and no food. The sun is intense above 5,000 feet, even if it's only 75 degrees. The German guy refuses water or any other help and just crosses the road, goes off into the woods. The ranger told us he can't really keep the guy from doing that, since he seemed okay. He said he'd check a few campsites in that direction later to see if he made it. We get to Snow Lake and commence drinking like fish in order to better catch fish. That evening the ranger pops by to tell us that nobody at any other camp had seen the dude. He radioed around and no other rangers had abandoned camps or missing campers, and they surely hadn't seen a German dude in purple pimp sweet suit. That ranger rolled off duty the next day and his replacement came by to make sure the other ranger was smoking something we gave him. We assured him it all happened. Never heard another word about the German in the purple pimp sweet suit, but makes for a good story. Update. Thanks for all the interest. I texted my buddy that was with me that day to reminisce about the German, and he reminded me that the purple pimp German looked a lot like the actor Isai Fens who played Nigel the kicker in the Keanu Reeves classic The Replacements. Hope that helps with the mental image. The movie came out like 3 years after the camping trip, but we remember seeing the moving and thinking Nigel looked just like the crazy German. My friend reiterated how absolutely happy the German was. German tourists are different. I was doing some stuff in Death Valley NP a couple of summers ago and left via the opposite direction of the construction crew, so this is a secondhand story. As we were all leaving after a very long night of pouring concrete, they should have been done at around sunrise, but things didn't finish up until like 1 PM or so. The archaeologist, let's call him Art, saw a faint glimmer of silver in a bush. Thinking that it was an old balloon, a huge problem, don't release balloons, they always come down somewhere and end up as litter, he turned around to retrieve it. Instead he found a German man sitting there under car windshield sunscreen thing with a piece of rolling luggage by his side. This was an area that was closed off to the public until the road was repaired and nobody would be back through until the next day, so he stopped to talk to the man. Apparently, the German man, Klaus is a good German name, let's use that, had been dropped off by his wife and mother-in-law the afternoon before and was in the middle of a long hike, like 20 to 30 miles or so. He had been hiking all night and was taking a break to rest during the day. There were plans to meet up in a day or two, but the women were in Vegas at the casinos. After some discussion, Art learned that Klaus had no food or supplies and had only drank a few sips from one of his three 1/2-liter water bottles since he began the trek. He thought rationing it would be best, since he only had a small amount of water. The temperature was already in the 120°F range and Art had to explain that the guy could not stay there or he would very literally die. Klaus said that he would be fine because he trained by sitting in a sauna a number of times before he left Germany, plus how would his wife know where to pick him up if they left? After explaining the difference between sitting in a sauna and hiking with no food in a dry desert, Art proceeded to question what would happen if his wife's car broke down, or if she got delayed for some reason. There is no phone service in that part of the park and nobody was supposed to be in the area to begin with, so Klaus would be sole if his wife didn't arrive. Klaus finally agreed to jump into Art's truck and drive to the nearby town, 20 miles away. As soon as he got into the account of the truck and took a few sips of cool water, Klaus realized how hot his body actually was and that he was actually in pretty bad shape. When they got to the town, they actually Klaus' wife and mother-in-law in the parking lot of the only gas station. It turns out that they had broken down there and never made it to Vegas. After talking a little, Art had to get off to sleep. He had been up all night and reminded Klaus to grab his roller suitcase from the back of the truck. Art casually asked what was inside and Klaus opened it to reveal a suitcase full of water bottles. Klaus was so delirious from heat that he forgot the heavy bag that he had somehow been rolling across the desert was full of water. Delirium like that is a sign of sunstroke. Klaus probably wouldn't have made it through the rest of the day had Art not insisted on him getting into the truck. Thank you so much for watching the whole video. Please leave a like and subscribe.